for everything that you've done for us. We thank you, Lord, for being there and always, Lord, knowing, Lord, the desires of our hearts and always knowing that, Lord, our desire is to please you. Father, we know this morning that we have many sick, and Lord, the flu and corona and everything else is going around. Everybody's fretting about something. But Lord, this morning we know that you are a great God and Father, that you know all about it and that you know how to take care of your children. So Lord, this morning we just pray that you would. Thank you for the newborn babies that we have. Thank you, Lord, for the very life that you've given to us in Jesus Christ. And Lord, without him this morning, I don't even know what we would do. But I do know that Jesus Christ is not in the tomb. He's not dead. He rose from the grave. I do know that he ascended to where you are, and he's coming back real soon. And so, Father, I just pray that you'd help us and teach us your way this morning, that we can live godly and live with the expectation of his soon coming. Be with us now, and we give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name as we surrender all afresh and anew. And everybody said, amen.
Good morning. Let's all stand to our feet, and let's take just a minute and greet the few that are here. If you know you're sick, please don't hug and get in someone's face, but let people know you're glad to see them this morning and that you love them. Let's all stand and sing our offertory hymn, Footsteps of Jesus. Footprints calling lead us to thee. Footprints. the cold, dark mountain seeking his sheep, or along by Siloam's fountain helping the weak. Footprints of Jesus that makes a pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where
Jesus makes it right. How many of y'all believe that? That just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. You know, when I grew up, we grew up on old Southern gospel music and those old hymns. And this is an old hymn out the archives. So I hope y'all just listen to the words, and I know you know it, so y'all sing along with me.
Question is, has he touched you? Amen. I sure hope. If he hasn't, before it's over, he will. Good to see y'all this morning. We are still fighting sickness, I'll tell you. I don't know when it's going to end, but it could be any time as far as I'm concerned. Amen. But it's sure good to be in the house of the Lord. And the Bible says, and I read it, where two or more of you gathered in my name, I will be in the midst. So let's see. One, two. Yeah, I see two. So I think we're going to be all right. And so we're going to be in the Psalms 137. If you have your Bibles there, you can turn with me. If not, look up on the screen. It'll be there, and you can kind of see where we're going. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept. And when we remembered Zion, we hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they carried us away captive, required of us a song, and they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? If I forgot thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget her cunning. If I do not remember thee, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. If I prefer not Jerusalem above my chief joys. Remember, O Lord, the children of Edom in the day of Jerusalem, who said, raise up, raise it, even to the foundation thereof. A daughter of Babylon, who art to be destroyed, happy shall he be, that afterwards thee, as thou hast served us, happy shall he be, that taketh and dasheth my little ones against the stone. Father, give us some wisdom to understand this morning. Understanding, Lord, that we might know what it is that you have chose to say to us today. And Lord, let us have ears to hear, a heart that is wide open to receive, and a life that's ready to change. And Lord, do good for all of our days that we have left here on this earth. Thank you for blessing those who have been down and cast out. Thank you for caring for those who have been on the highways going back and forth to doctors. Lord, thank you for being with us when we were asleep last night to keep the devil from killing us. Lord, we have so many that are sick. Still, it's the Columbus County crud. And Lord, we pray for each one who's battling that today. Lord, may your hand guide us and keep our thoughts your thoughts. And let our ways be your ways. And Lord, let our praise be to you and to you only. For we ask it in Christ Jesus our Lord. And everybody said, there's a passage that, as we were reading there, that something stood out. And so I want to come back to it because I think it's important that we get it all. It says, if I do not remember thee, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. If I prefer not Jerusalem above my chief joy. I want you to, we'll try to explain that as we go down into it. If I prefer not Jerusalem above my chief joy. And that's prioritizing putting things first. Well, let me give you a little bit of background this morning on our text and on our scripture. In our text today, of course, we know the reason that Israel, Judah, are out of place. They've been brought into the captivity of Babylon. And it's because of their sinning against God. It's because of the way they had lived. This was God's last choice, not God's first choice. Because he offered them and came to them and offered them a way to repentance. And they wouldn't take it. They wouldn't receive it. And as a part of the punishment which God gave them, it was that they were going to be, the kings were going to come over and take them and carry them into the land of captivity. And that's where we find them. And if you're not careful, if you live in the wrong way, that's where you're going to find yourself. And that's where you're going to spend some time. You may not be physically in what was Babylon, or you may not be carried away captive somewhere, but I promise you, where you are at will be a captive place. And it's a place. But anyhow, he talks about a strange land here, and it is a strange land to people. And that the Lord in the wilderness, God did not intend the wilderness to be a place that the people grew accustomed to and enjoyed it. The wilderness was a place that they were not supposed to enjoy and get on out of the way and get on in to the land of promise. He didn't want them to get happy and get comfortable there. He don't want you happy and comfortable here. He don't want you to just enjoy yourself to death, so to speak, here in this land. This world is not my home. We're just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. Now, when you think about all this and we think about what God is doing, this is what we need to hear today. And I'm just going to take this thing, and you hope you can see the picture because God paints. He says, by the river of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. Now, you young people are not crazy about the old songs. It's because they're not dear to you yet. You don't remember the old songs of Zion. I'll fly away don't have a lot of meaning to you. You know, in those them old homes, I won't have to cross Jordan alone. And just go right on back and as far as you can go back. And I can remember years ago when Shirley Hilburn sang that song, He Touched Me. Yes, He Touched Me. And that's when she was a very young woman and I was a young man. And that's been a long time. But even the music itself was an indicator that it was from the old heritage. And what's happening today, and we shared this in a message with you some time ago, that the noise down where Moses had left Aaron and the children of Israel before he went to the mount to get the law of God, the noise of their sin was stronger than the communion with the Lord up in the mountain. And that's what drew the attention of Moses and the Lord to draw him back down to see what the devil was going on. And he said, Lord, what's going on down there? And he says, I'll go see. Of course, when he got down there, we know that he saw all that was happening, and it angered him so, he threw the tablets down, and they break the tablets of the law of God, and went over and did what he had to do. And of course, many thousand people died there that day. He gave them the opportunity, if you're on the Lord's side, stand with me. But if you're not, yet you're gonna, and they were died by the thousands. Because they had already, in just that short, whether it be a day or 2 days or less than a day, in that short period of time, they'd already adapted false worship. They'd already turned back to sexual sin. And the worldliness, they picked it up in just that short period of time. Now, I want to tell you, there's coming another time. There's going to be a 1,000-year break between the man and sin. Everything's going to be under the hand of Christ. He's going to sit on the throne of David in Jerusalem, and he's going to rule for 1,000 years. There will not be sin. The lion will lay down with the lamb. It's going to be a time of peace. And at the end of 1,000 years, Satan will be unloosed with his angels. And at the end of 1,000 years, men will go back to worshiping this world and the things of it. It says that, and of course, that this the anger of God is so infused by their actions that God just simply said, that's it, and he begins to destroy it all. And so we need to find out how God feels about sin before we continue any further in it. God does not appreciate sin. God hates sin. The things he talks about that he hates is sin. And so what we need to do is we need to learn not to walk in sin, because these people, and now you can see, after we get caught doing things, that's when we sit by the river brook and whine because we've been caught in our sin. Because that sin, when we remember and reflect on Zion and what we had in Zion, it's then that there won't be no peace to come to us. There won't be no joy that would come to us. We'll just be bound by the very sin that we thought was so joyful while we were going through it. And that's the picture we have right here. It says we sat down and we wept. That's what you, when you come to a time when you realize your health is gone, your wealth is gone, your family's gone, and everything you had is gone, it's then that you'll begin to weep and realize that it was sin that took it all away from you. And then, you see, that's when we weep, when we reflect on when it was good, when we were in Zion, when everything was well, and what sin has done to us. There's been many a broken man and woman. There's been many a young person that has taken their own lives because they couldn't live with their circumstances. And there'll be many more before it's over with. I'll tell you, church is becoming an afterthought for so many in our world today. Even in the Bible Belt, unless we got some kind of a pony, horse and pony show that's going on that will draw people to such as that. But if God can't draw you, then whatever you need to do is get on the altar somewhere and seek the Lord's face. Lord, please make yourself real to me. Lord, please make me know that it's you. I don't want this artificial stuff that's being handed out on every corner. Everywhere we turn and everywhere we look, people are sad as they sit by the river brook and realize their sin. And as it goes on there, I just want you to kind of pick up with me. It says, we hang our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. You see, they had a song in their heart. They had a song in their heart, and the harp was one of the chief instruments that they used during the days of David. David, you know, must have been somewhat a musician, because he himself liked music. The people did, and I'm sure, had you been in the temple on the Lord's day, you probably would have heard these psalms being sung, because Paul wrote to us that we would sing in our heart songs, that we would sing the songs, that we would sing the message of the Lord in our hearts. And that singing the song of the Lord in our heart, that was is what prevents sin from ruling in our heart when we have the thought and the things of the Lord. I remember as a child, we would leave church and I could sing the song. I remember that song Stephanie was singing. I've never individually sung it in my life, but I remember the words. I could stand here and sing it to you right now. He touched me and he made me whole. You can remember that because of it's a message in it, and it's an emphatic message. It took his touch to make me whole. And I can't be whole any other way. If you got a hole in your life, Jesus can fill the hole and the void in your life. He is what's missing. If he's missing, there's a big part of your joy is gone. And so, but you see, we try to fill that in, these people, and they'll get over it. They'll get over it because the Lord's going to restore them from the captivity. In fact, he said, I will go and I will gather you from the places that I've sent you. I will gather you back to this and bring the joy back to you. And the Lord is even in the process of gathering right now this people that went off into captivity. He's in that process right now. And when that process is almost complete, they tell me they got the red heifers that for the sacrifice in the new temple that's going to be built. They tell me that the buzzards have already multiplied to eat the flesh of those that are going to come in and are going to try to destroy that place. I'm just going to tell you, I read the end of the book, I jumped ahead, and I want you to know God is never again going to scatter his people. Amen. God is never again going to scatter his people. He's gathering his people, and when the gathering is through, it will be done. Amen. And so today is a good day for you to express yourself before the Lord, how much you love and need him, and just ask him to come in this cold moment of life and bring calm to the senselessness of sin. Amen. And I think if we'll do that, I think that our life will probably take on a whole new deal. Amen. It says they were there. It says, and they hanged their harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they carried us away captive. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song. And they that wasted us required of us mirth. You know what mirth is, don't you? Mirth is joy. They required of us saying, sing one of the songs of Zion. As if mocking them. They didn't want to hear the song because of the message that was in the song. They wanted to hear the song to be entertained. And we got a lot of that going on today. We set the mood of worship, we say, with worship and praise. Why, churches that can afford it have hired worship leaders. And worship leaders work us into a frantic state. And then when we see the old boy in his blue jeans and his Hawaiian shirt mount the pulpit with his iPad and read a message that the old boy out there in Houston is posting on it, then we know what's wrong in the church. Now, I'm going to tell y'all something. People say, well, it's good as long as people's getting saved. I want to tell you, it ain't good. The Lord said, everybody says, come over here. It's not good. Look here. We've got to realize, and we've got to be reminded this morning, we need to have that song in our heart that we sing. And folks, I don't listen to Grandma Got Run Over by the Reindeer and then go into the Lord's house and think that I'm going to be rejoiced by Grandma Got Run Over by the Reindeer. People today are getting married in the church want to sing country songs. People today that are being buried in the church want to come in here and sing some worldly mess that Ma or Pa or Grandpa like. They want to bring that worldly mess to the final moment of people's life together. I don't know what's happened to us except that we got too far out there in the wilderness of sin, and we need to be drawn back today by God calling us. How can we sing a song of God in a strange land? And that would really be the topic. That's the next verse that's there. How can we sing the song of God in a strange land? There's just no place of singing. And we got people that are listening. I got a phone call this week. I got family members that are looking for a place to worship. They got two preachers in their family, and they're looking for somewhere else to worship. It's because it's a rebellious spirit that God's going to hurt them, and God's going to stop them. And I'm sitting here on edge waiting to hear that God stopped them. When it does not have to be. It's a rebellious spirit. It's a Jezebel spirit that wants to control instead of an open heart to worship. And it's going to come back and it's going to hurt. If you got family, you better treat them with the right dignity and with the right respect. If you don't, God is going to come back and treat and correct you before you know what's happening. You'll wake up with chest pain. You'll wake up with cancer growing in you. You better be sure your sins will find you out. You can't sing when you've got nothing to sing about. And that's the deal. And that's what we don't realize. We've got to work it out. We've got to quit game playing. Look here, I don't try to cover up nothing in our home or in our family, and you better not try to cover it up in yours. Because I want you to know the one who knows everything knows all things. And he knows all his hands. And he knows how to deal with these people sitting over there. Yeah, I'm telling you, I'm touched in my heart by the very reading of the text this morning, just sitting there by the brook, and they're brokenhearted because their sin has brought them to this place when they can't even sing. When they don't even have a song in their heart because they live the wrong way. How many warnings is it going to take before you realize and come to your senses that you need to repent? How many trips away to a foreign land is it going to take for you to bring you back to your loved ones? I mean, we have a promise of that, and we have a promise of that. But the truth is, we don't have no promise of tomorrow. If tomorrow will never come except the Lord grant us the authority of tomorrow. Yesterday's gone, and today is the only opportunity we have right now that we can impact the rest of our life by making a decision here today. Do y'all realize that? I've seen so many people. You know, one of the most money-making organizations is those people who make medicines. They are now, it's so out of control, they're making appeals to the government. Medicine, $1,200, $1,400 per prescription. They're making appeals to the government. Please help us. We got to have medicines. The Bible says my people are sick. My people are, is there not a bomb in Gilead? Not only are people physically sick, they are spiritually sick. Is there not a bomb in Gilead? What in the world and how much longer will God have to stand at the door and knock before we will come to our senses? Here's what they're saying. One of the most prominent fields of employment is medical, absolutely, because everybody thinks they're sick. Nobody has a song to sing anymore. I'm going to tell you something. If you keep on sitting in the house, you'll get where you can't even walk, can't even get up out of a chair because you're sick. You told yourself long enough, bless God, now it's come on you. You can be as sick as you want to, or you can get up in the name of Jesus and walk as far as he'll carry you, amen. And if he ain't carrying you, go on and go home, amen. So I'm telling you right now, we live in such an age. And people's lives are being altered by all these medicines. Their minds are being altered. And there's so much going on. We just about need a rehab for the church people. We got so much going on. You know it and I know it. And so you don't duck away from me. You know it as well as I do. We couldn't live without the medicines we got, we think. We think that. Amen? And if y'all ever heard the disclaimers, they got this new thing, and the disclaimers are it could kill you. I mean, it just doing all kind of things. And once you get on, don't you stop without contacting your physician because it can kill you. You're going to get three or four more things when you're trying to help the one you got, amen? You see, a man told me the other day, he says, I know I'm going to die. I've got all that worked out. I'm not afraid of dying. I'm not afraid of death. But the truth of it is, when we don't have the joy of the Lord in our heart, We fight as hard as we can to live. But you know what? If the Bible is everything and the heaven is everything that I read in the Bible, and God's going to be there to wait for me when I cross the valley and it says so, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Tells me that, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table for me in the presence of mine enemies. Whoa, glory. And it just gets on. If all that's true, why do we fight? Why do we try to hold on? If all that's true, I'll tell you why. Because you like me, you love your family. I love y'all. And I'm afraid that some of you disperse if God were to take me out of here. And you probably would be less committed than you are now. I tell you, it just hurts to think about that, how easy things can turn to nothing. It just hurts down to the very bottom of the heart to realize how many walk away without even thinking about what they're doing. Not even thinking about it. We need to be careful. So they get over there. And then here comes their captors and said, why don't y'all take your harps down off the willows there and sing a song? Sing a song of Zion. You know what they were doing? They were mocking them. They were mocking them. What about that group that's mocking you, that's saying, what are you doing out here? You know, you claim to be a Christian. Don't you go over there to New Horizon? What are you doing where I'm at? They're mocking you. They're mocking you. You can't sing a song at a joint down at the beach. You can't sing a song when you're out there in sin with the world that's full of sinners. What song do you have? It ain't the song of Zion. That's the sadness. That's the tears of being by the brook. You can't sing your song in that crowd that you run with, because sin's what got you to the crowd you with to begin with. And you can't sing that song. That's exactly what was going on. They couldn't take them harps down and play no more. They couldn't sing those songs because they were in a strange land. Now listen to me. This is important to the very utmost. This is important. This is your rest of your life hangs in the balance. Listen to this message this morning. What got you? What brought you into captivity? What will keep you in captivity? And what will leave you and lead you out of captivity? It's all right here in the lessons. We need to hear this lesson. You young people, look here. I don't care if you don't never work nowhere but the IGA. If that's what it takes in your life, work at the IGA. But don't ever walk away from God. Don't ever let your friends turn you away from God. Working at the IGA, I'm not mocking that. I never had a job publicly. In my life, I was in the military, all of it, and then the Lord called me to preach. But I'm just telling you something. You think that you've got to run with this group and that group? You're so busy. I know some are so busy, I can't even get up with them. They're running from thing to thing, but they're running in sin. It's going to be a sad day. I remember down at Sweet Home Church when there were two white coffins sitting down there. One of them was my niece and one of them was her friend. 18 years old and seniors in high school. Dead. Church full, standing room on the balcony is full. Oh, that was some of the most pitiful day in the world. Mothers and fathers mourn for the rest of their days the loss of them children. They mourn for them. But they were on their way home innocently, racing. Y'all, you boys want to soup them trucks up? You want to go down there where they're running this stuff and playing these games? Will we get the call from y'all one night? They didn't mean it, but they dead as a doornail, preacher. They dead. Race the next clown that pulls up beside you and ask you what you got. Go ahead. Go to the longest road you can go and run it wide open and see if it don't bust your brains out in just a little while. Preacher, you think I believe that? I'm a better driver than that. You may very well be, but you'll be a good dead driver. That's the thing that you need to get a hold of. And it's the same way about anything called sin. You might know somebody that's doing something that they call themselves upright and holy, I want to tell you, just because they do it, it don't give you a permit to do it. They're going to go to the same hell you do if you copy them. Because I want you to understand, Christians don't have no right nor permit to do any sin. None whatsoever. It don't matter what you name it. No, Christians don't have the right. And when we take a right to sin, that's when we stand in the judgment of sin, which is death. It's right here in the book. And I don't know no clearer or plainer way to put it down there. You know what? I hate it. I hate it when my family members rebel. I hate it because I want you to understand something. You say, well, what are you talking about? Because I'm trying to help you, because you're doing the same thing. Trying to help you realize that you got to put the hammer down on your families. I don't know why wouldn't you want a relationship with your family? Why wouldn't grandfathers and grandmothers want to see their children and their grandchildren? What in the world is going on with people? And I want to tell you people something. If you got family members, you may not like them, but let me tell you something. The Bible says you're supposed to love them and be a witness. Don't you let your witness tear down their life, because I want you to understand, it ain't going to be pretty. It just don't make sense to drive 40, 50 miles when you're 3 miles from where your family's at to go to church. Are y'all listening to me? It don't make no sense. It's rebellion. It's a rebellious spirit. And God destroys rebellious spirits. And that's the thing I want you to remember. Anyhow, he says, they required of us to be joyful. Well, I mean, you might as well make yourself happy. I mean, you've been caught for breaking in somebody's house. You're out there at Tabor City inmate, correct? And they tell you, you might as well be happy. You're going to have a long time here. That's what sin does to you. It keeps you longer than you could ever imagine. It don't look like it's ever going to come to an end. You might as well be happy. It's like your parents giving you a good lashing with a belt, a switch. And they tell you, you might as well be happy. Because you deserve what you got. This hurts me more than it hurts you. Did y'all ever see that? I never could figure that one out yet. Could y'all? Mama's gone now, but I always wanted her to tell me, Mama, how can that possibly be? Look at them legs there where you left them streets. Amen? Can I'm going to tell y'all something. That was a badge of honor. When I went to school, I didn't try to cover up my streaks where I got my rear end whipped, because they had them on their legs too. Back then, parents were parents, and they trained the children up. They just didn't drag them up and give them everything they wanted. They come to school with streaks on their legs from them little switches that you had to go get, and they got the rear end tuned up and turned around. We don't do that no more. Well, look at what we got. We got policemen guarding the schools that they go to. That tells you a whole lot, doesn't it? That's why these people were over there in Babylon, is because the discipline of God was not sufficient for them. They wanted to rebel and go against what God had told them not to do. Over and again, I can just go take you through it, read with you, and just show you over and again how many times God came and pled with these people and told them that Babylon, that they're going to come and carry them off. They took the gold cups and stuff out of the temple and then burned the temple. They took the treasures, all the treasures of Israel and Judah. They took them to Babylon in the king's house. I'm telling y'all what's the truth. These people didn't care. They were the rod in the hand of God that was punishing the sinful in the congregation of Israel. The rod in the hand of God is a dangerous concept when you sin. Very dangerous, because God is not responsible nor accountable, because he told you not to do it. He told me not to do it. He told you what to think, and he told you how to walk, and he told you how to live. God is not responsible when that rod is raised up. I want you to understand that's what sin does. That's what happens. And it'll take you so long. Anyway, it says they commanded them to be glad that they were in there, and they told them, sing one of the songs of Zion. There'll come a day when you wish you could be here one more time to hear one more song of Zion. There'll come a day when there won't be nobody to drop by and pick you up. Won't even call you very much. That there'll come a day when your desire. I could go down the list that I know that's right here, and they're on that wall back there, a lot of them. I sit in their homes and listen to them say, oh, I wish I could be there again. I wish. I got a call from Miss Hardy the other day, and she said, Preacher Tom, I love my church. I do wish that I could be there. I'm just telling y'all something. The day will come when you will wish that you had done more while you could do more. The day will come when you'll wish you had walked a little closer than you walked. Because I'm going to tell you something. The day, the darkness is coming. We need to know that. Sing us one of those songs of Zion. And here's what they said. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Now, I want to tell y'all something. If you'll go back over there and you'll read the journey of the children of Israel from Exodus and read it through, you won't find out where there's very many joyous occasions while they're in that wilderness. You won't find it. I'm telling you right now, when you find them in rebellion. Who would have ever thought, listen to me, who would have ever thought when you read about God and in the days of creation, the Bible said he created the lights that are in the heaven. He created the trees and the growth that's on the earth. He did all kind of creation. He established fruit trees and all other kinds. He established everything. And then in the end, he made man and put him in the center of this creation and told him to dress it and have dominion over all of his creation. That's what God told him. I can show you the instruction. And they got in there, and they were doing all that stuff, Adam and Eve and the rest of God's creation. They were in union together. And one day, while in that garden, I don't know, folks, I don't think it's because women are weaker. I don't blame women because sin came into this world, but many people do. But one day Eve was out there in the midst of that garden, and I don't know what the devil was doing there. I told y'all, I don't know what he was doing in there. Of all of the perfect things God did, why would he let the devil be in the midst of that garden? I don't know, but you didn't see him there until God said, don't eat of that tree. I guess when God gives us commands not to do things, that's when the devil shows up to try to prove God don't have the power to keep you. And so, but anyhow, she was out there, and here was that serpent that was most subtle. And he began a conversation with her. Number one, I can warn y'all that the conversation is what leads to sin. So I can warn y'all in your conversation, that means in your lifestyle, that's where the devil's going to tempt you to sin. And when you sin, it's too late after you've eaten the fruit that God said not eat, because sin is sin. It's too late. Sin needs something to cleanse it. And the Bible said if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to cleanse. But I want y'all to really look there. We see this here today, but I really want you to look at Eden. What happened to them? They got thrown out of the garden. They got thrown out of this perfect place, this perfect paradise. And they began to have children. What happened in their children? Their children raised up against each other. One killed another. There you have murder. Then the children of the men on the earth, the sons of men, and the angels of God began to breed together, and there were giants in the land. Can y'all see how where sin from that tree led all the way to the death of their sons and daughters, and then to the intermingling sexually where they should not, and all the perversion that came immediately to the land? You don't think you can go that far that quick. But you can go overnight from where you didn't want to go. You'll be there tomorrow if you're not careful with sin. That conversation is what gets us into sin. Now, listen. You know what sin is. And if you don't know, you need to get somebody to print you off copies of it and post it somewhere, if it's not on your refrigerator. But And in the end part of sin, the last thing you need to put up there, whatever is not of faith is sin. That's what the scripture says. Whatever is not of faith is sin. But he also lists things like this. He says, for example, killing, stealing, idolaters. You know, you can just take the commandment, and out of that arises all these things. And it tells you what, and just make a list of them. And then when you have a conversation that you're going to embark on some of these sins, then you'll know what the answer God has for it is. It'll be by a river brook, and your song will be gone. Amen. Do y'all understand? Do you realize if this book right here is written for Christians? And it is, because you can't understand that what's in here without the Spirit of God. And you can't have the Spirit of God in you unless Christ is in you, because the Spirit will lead you into all truth, and he'll give you understanding about the Word of God and how you're supposed to live. If you know that this is going on among Christians, my God, what you think it's going to be like in the world. You ever thought about that? Just anything goes. Anything goes. We were talking this morning. We're in a small place called Tabor City. Now, what are there, 2,500 people maybe in the whole surrounding area? Whiteville may have 3,000 or that many. But you look like a city like New York City, Los Angeles, California, San Francisco. Just any state, pick the capital city. And there are masses of people. And what's happening here, see, we know everything. We know everybody. Somebody gets shot, we know them. Or know of them. We've heard of them. But in places like that, nobody knows. If they live a block away, they don't know. People are pulled themselves in and don't want to get involved in other people's lives. If you've never lived in a city like that, you don't understand that. But they don't want nothing to do with you. Get out of my face. Everybody, whoever thought we'd have a homosexual running for president? Already determined what he's going to call his, whatever you call it. He's going to be the first gentleman. Y'all serious? Oh, I'm about to puke right now. Excuse me just a minute. Just to think that we've arrived at such a point. Just to think that we've got a communist leading the ballots and leading in votes that could be the president of our country. Don't that make you sick? You know why we're there? Because there's too many people that's by the brook that left Zion because of sin. Because of sin. And you see, that's what happens. But they got over there, they said, sing a song. We ain't got no song. Be happy. We can't be happy. How can we be happy? Well, sing one of them their Lord songs. How can we do it in a strange land? You know what I think has happened here today in the last little bit? I think the Lord has given me the key to revival. I think that he has given me the key to revival. We have made our churches a strange place to be. We set our churches up, and the anchors of the church are worldly. And we don't think that we can go on without these worldly anchors. Well, I want to tell you, we can go on. Press on. Do you remember Samson? Now, Samson was a horrific sinner. He loved women. And if you don't know that, you haven't read about Samson. When he was a younger boy, he saw a woman and told his mom and dad, "Bring her, I want her. You're not supposed to have her. But I want her, mom and daddy." And they brought her over there to him. He wasn't supposed to put his hand on a dead carcass. He went over there and eat honey out of a dead carcass. They tell him all the time, "You're not supposed to do that." And he went through all that stuff, and he ended up with that old sweet gal over there, and they were laying up together, and every day she was tugging on his heartstring, "If you love me, you'd tell me." What is it? Where is it that you find your strength? He'd tell her something, and she'd do it and bind him, and when they came in, he'd break the bonds and all that mess, kill a bunch of them. But she persisted. They had a conversation. Oh, come on, everybody's doing it. We'll just be safe. We'll just be safe. We'll have safe sex. Well, he felt sorry for her. Conversation turned to his strength. And in that heated moment of love, he said, it's my hair. If you just cut my hair. His hair was his testimony. That vow that he had made to the Lord. Don't let a razor come on your hair. Don't have your hand and touch no dead carcass. That conversation that we're talking about, that joy that we're talking about. See, they came in on him that night, and he moved himself to break the bands, and the bands wouldn't break. He had gone too far. He had hung his harp up on the bush over there. There was no more song, no more joy in his heart, because immediately they podged his eyes out. They blinded him. He didn't have the strength to stop. They blinded him. Bound him up, made him a spectacle before the people. Tie him up out there and let them come by and see him and mock him and hiss at him. See, that's what the devil has done to the church in America today and around the world. They tied our hands up and openly are mocking us because they see in us. We got the House Speaker telling the President he ain't no Christian, he don't know nothing about prayer, and him mocking her. What kind of mess have we got going on in America? We got about anything in the churches. Now we got it in the government. Everybody's accusing everybody, telling everybody who's a Christian. Nobody knows who's a Christian is, except, you know, we know that what God says we ought to be. But you don't really know in a man's heart. And so here we are. We're in such a mess, we don't even know how to act no more. Children rule the parents. You read about children over there near the lake over there. This boy killed his grandma because she wouldn't give him money. Killed her. Had to feed that habit. I'm telling you, rebellion. This stuff going on. But these people had done. But Samson. Samson, they took him out there, and Samson's hair began to grow back. That's the one thing that they overlooked in his life. That there would become a day when that forgiveness would come. He cried out to the Lord. And when he cried out to the Lord, he was hooked to the columns that held the city. And when he pulled his arms together, with God's strength, the whole thing colluded. And he did more damage in that day. He destroyed so many people. I want to tell you something. A lot of people have to go through that. A lot of people have to ruin their life and waste their witness in ministry only to find a few days of victory at the end of their life. There ain't no sense in it. There's really no sense in it. There's no reason to see what we're seeing. When are we going to deal with it? When are we going to really get serious about it? I want to tell y'all something. I believe it's this microphone right here. Ain't this the one they replaced? Michelle. You know how much that microphone costs? We got two more hand jobs to go with it. Over $1,000. You realize that in this room right here, we're getting ready to do some redecorating. You know how much it's going to cost just to tear this mess out and put it back? Over $50,000. But let me tell you something. We have been blessed beyond measure to have, can afford this kind of stuff. But why are we going to have it if we don't have no song? Why do you need $1,000 worth of microphone? Why do we need this stuff? I appreciate it. To me, I thank God I'm so thankful. When these youngins pick up and begin to sing, it means something to me. It blesses my heart because I got that song in my heart. I'm not by a brook somewhere because I've been cast out because of sin. Now listen to me. I want to tell y'all something. I like the best. This is the Lord's house. If we could, we ought to overlay all this stuff with gold. That's how serious I am. I'm serious about everything we do for the Lord. He told them people, he says, you bring gold and you bring silver and you bring the trees from Lebanon. You bring the best material. You bring your best when you bring it to the Lord. I'm for every bit of that. You hear me? But I'm for somebody stepping up saying I'm on the Lord's side. Who is on the Lord's side? I live it in the community. Live it in Tabor City. Live it like the old boy that used to be a painter that's dead and gone now. When he got saved, he went around to Elbert Waddell. Tell everybody about Jesus. Let everybody know that you're excited about it. And tell them what God has done for you. When's the last time you cleansed yourself in public and did that? When you pick your girlfriend up, hey, honey, I'm so glad for what God did for me today. Hallelujah. I'm not over here to lead you into sin. I'm over here to lead you to Christ. Come here, honey. I love you in Jesus Christ. She'd probably say, don't pick me up no more. You're gone crazy because you never done it before. Why would it be so strange that you would do it today? See, that's what happens. Our inconsistency. So what we're going to do, we're going to come up with a new deal, a new day. I don't want to spend the rest of my life remembering what was. I want to spend my life knowing what is, and I am. He said, I am. That means every day you get up, book, I am. That's him. He's eternal. And if you'll just look at this passage of Scripture, see the pain in their heart, the joy that's gone out of their life. Jeremiah chapter 7, you can find this two or three times in chapter 7. And as you read on, you'll find it some more times throughout the book of Jeremiah. But it says, because of their sin, I will take away their mirth, their gladness, the voice of the bridegroom, and the voice of the bride. I will take it away from you because you have sinned. And you have declared you have the right to live the way you're living. You have declared that it's all right if you sin. You have declared that and you know that it's not true. Therefore, I'll take all that away from you. You know, that's why somebody that comes up in through country music or somewhere, they could be Christians, but if you can learn to sing, you can sing any song. You can sing a song that's full of the Spirit and it won't affect you. If you can sing, you can sing. But everybody that sings ain't singing in the Spirit. Judy's Uncle Jay told me, he said, I've heard some stuff they used to travel and sing. And he said these quartets would get up there and say, whatever we need to do, we got to go win that crowd. And they'd talk ugly. They'd talk about dirty things. Whatever we need to do. They'd pull up on these big travel buses with somebody else's wife instead of theirs. Them groups that you bought all their tapes and listened to all their testimonies with somebody else's wife. Instead of going on the road to win souls, they're on the road to make money and have a good time. Not all of them, but many of them. That's the thing. That's the whole deal. We need to try the spirits, guys. Listen, let's read on now. We'll be through. It's about done. Oh, yeah. If I forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget her cunning. If I do not remember thee, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. If I prefer not Jerusalem above my chief joy. You know what that is, don't you? Putting him first. If I prefer anything, above Jerusalem, my chief joy. That would become my chief joy. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. You know what amazes me, y'all? It's when I read this stuff, it's just like a reading, not reading necessarily a newspaper, but just looking at the People Today book, just how they're living. That's in there, isn't it? It's right there. And you think about, did y'all remember the psalm that he preached on the other morning? I thought to myself, my God, how timely that is. But that's just the way it is. It's right there. Remember, O Lord, the children of Edom in the day of Jerusalem, who said, raise it, even to the foundation, tear it down. O daughter of Babylon, who art to be destroyed, happy shall he be that rewardeth thee as thou hast served us. Happy shall he be that taketh and dasheth thy little ones against the stones. Serious. Serious business. You know what the Lord told him? When he went over there to see him, he said, I'll take you wives and give them to some other man. I'll take your children and I'll put them on the end of a sword because of your sin. Is your wife or children important to you? Is your life worth saving? Then I'm going to ask you today, in the lovely, holy name of Jesus, to humble yourselves at a place on this altar. And here's all you got to say. Lord, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. That's it. And go from there. As we have our invitation, I'm going to ask you to do that. Not trying to embarrass nobody, not trying to pick nobody out and single anybody out. But you know, and God knows where you're at and what's going on. You and him have an interaction this morning. And let him help you. He's wanting to help you. As we stand, would you come? What are we doing?